Mr. Or-Bach is the holder of more than 25 US patents issued.
300.
He is a world recognized expert in monolithic 3D technology. What if these three technology, maybe most of us will learn today? He is also the founder of and CEO of the monolithic 3D. He also published a landmark paper entitled A 1000 Improvement in Computer System and Bridges the Processor Memory Gap. He has many contributions. He was many times invited as a guest speaker in USA, in Korea, Japan. He got a lot of prizes. Maybe you know, and I don't want to take too much because you have this short bio. Now, please, it's your time.
Okay, so I think I need first to make sure that my presentation is on, correct?
Okay, it works, it's perfect.
Yes, it works, and we can move forward and backward?
Yes.
Okay, I'm very glad that you can see my presentation. In this presentation, we are presenting a concept for new opportunities in the FPGA space. This is mostly concept, meaning it's not in going, but it's calling for entrepreneurs, teams that want to go for it. We will articulate the technology, and if there is interest, we will be happy to discuss it further and to help the concept become reality. The concepts themselves are built on existing technology and existing know-how and existing materials. So it's more about how to leverage existing technology to create new offering. So that is basically the story we're going to spend hour now talking about. The story has been detailed in a book chapter in a recent publication of a book called Nanochip 2030. It's chapter 11 of that book. Of course, there are other chapters that also have and could be of interest. For those that show interest to go deeper, the book chapter is available and you can discuss with Stefan about it. It might be that this presentation will leave some holes and those of interest may want to read more in the book and articulate themselves more about the concept further. So the agenda is first to introduce 3D integration using layer transfer hybrid bonding, because it's a fundamental technology that enables the 3D opportunity. And then we will show two ways of building a new type of FPGA. 3D FPGA that is much better than any FPGA currently available. And one of the concepts that we'll first articulate is relatively simpler. The other one is a little bit more challenging, but provide far more benefits. So those are two concepts. Each one of them is available, and a company can start with one and move to the other later on. But it's all built on 3D integration. Now, 3D integration is becoming real. And you can see now more and more about it. Sometimes people talk about advanced packaging, calling it the same way, but underneath it, it's basically the same technology. So, hybrid bonding has been around for quite a while. It was first became reality with Sony building product using hybrid bonding, control of the image sensor underneath the image sensor. Now this technology is spreading, and most foundries now, including TSMC, Global Foundry, and others, are adopting it, and it's available almost throughout the industry. TSMC is clearly the leader, and they are building two fabs to support it. So what is it? The concept is that you independently fabricate two wafers. So the wafer fabrication does not change. It's very much the same, just like before, using normal fab, normal process. Then you take one of the wafer, you flip it, and you bond it on the other wafer. The process of bonding is done at low temperature, so you don't really damage anything on those two wafers. And as you bond them, you achieve both oxide to oxide and metal to metal bonding. And accordingly, you achieve mechanical strength between those two wafers and also electrical connectivity between pads and pins when they arrange correctly to achieve both connectivity and mechanical structure. The connection pitch could be better than 1 micron, and over time, I'm pretty sure there will be more aggressive offering by more vendors. The beauty of the process is that it's available. It means that the two wafer can be processed in a way that is standard, but the end product is not standard. The bonded wafer could then be diced and packaged, whatever you want. So instead of having just one layer of transistor, you now could have multiple layers, clearly two or more. After you bond, you can thin down the top wafers. You can thin it beyond what normally wafer could be thin. So in the industry today, many times people are thinning the wafer after processing. To start with, in a process, the wafer is 700 micron. After finishing and before shipping to packaging, it may be grind and etch back to about 50 micron. Most time, people will not go beyond 50 micron for the reason that the structure will not be mechanical stable. So 50 micron is common, but aggressive more than that is not common. Once you bond it, and the mechanical strength is now could be from the base wafer, the top wafer could be thin much more than beyond 50 micron. 10 micron is pretty common, I would say, done by company like Tesseron and other companies. Many times in memory cube, they do it to the level of 20 micron, and other people have done it even to 4 and 3 micron. But it still need to be conservative because you don't have an edge stop. If you build an edge stop, then you can send it to beyond 1 micron or even to 500 nanometer, and we'll talk about it very soon. Once you do that, you can now do the TSV through the top silicon to create connection for IO, or if you want to prepare for the third wafer to be on top. In our discussion today, we are not going to go beyond two wafers, but in the future, people will go beyond two wafers. The bonding itself is done by an equipment that is designed to do such. EV Group in Austria is a market leader. I believe they have more than 50% of the market. But other people are offering capability like that, including Tel in Japan and other companies. Most companies are now at the range between 15 nanometer wafer to wafer misalignment, or sometime a little bit like 100 nanometer. But 15 nanometer has been actually announced by EV Group in 2018. So it's a mature technology. And it's now in production by a Chinese company calling it X stacking, when they build a 3D NAND array on one wafer, periphery control circuitry on another wafer, flip bond, and ship it in high volume production. So you can read more about it on YMTC website. They have a nice video and so forth. And as I said, TSMC are now building two fabs, talking about AMD and Google as early customer for this concept of stacking or 3D integration or hybrid bonding. TSMC called it 3D fabrics or SOIC. The stop edge or allow you to do extreme thinning. Why extreme thinning is important? Because if we want to go through the top wafer, the thinner it is, the smaller the via could be. If it's a 10 micron, then it's hard to do less than 10 micron via. If it's a 500 nanometer, 50 nanometer via is possible. And of course, small via allows faster, cheaper, better from any count. So how can you do an edge stop? It's very simple. When you start with a wafer, the substrate could go through a process of epi of SiGe and then epi of silicon. Such type of epi wafer is now becoming the common way for all the stuff that go beyond 5 nanometers. There's 4 nano, 3 nanometer, 2 nanometer, 1 nanometer nodes. They're all about a nanowire, nanosheet, whatever the name is. And they all use SiGe as silicon SiGe, and then to do the get all around by undercut the SiGe with a selective process. So it's a common practice in the industry. SiGe is a very common material. When the germanium within the silicon is 20% or less, it's relatively simple, no stress, nothing. SiGe is also used sometimes as a channel, sometimes as a stressor. So it's a very common material and very common now, as you can see below, for the advanced fab, this nano sheet kind of thing. In 2020, about 6 months ago, IMEC together with SPTES presented a paper about extreme wafer thinning, showing thinning for 500 nanometer using this concept. I believe this process has now been broadcast throughout the industry, and I hope that more and more fab will adapt it to offer it for the future. So kind of a summary of the 3D integration using hybrid bonding. You have two fabs. Those could be the same fab or fab. One fab that is focused on logic, the other fab could be focused on other type of technology. One fab could be very advanced node, the other fab could be less advanced node. The two wafers come out of the fab, one of them getting flip bond, and you have a SiGe, you can get rid of all the substrate etching down, as you can see in the right side of the picture. So that kind of process is either already available or about to become available and could be used in many ways. What TSMC is using together with Google and AMD is to bring memory on top of logic to make the performance of the processor better. What we will do in this presentation for 3D FPGA is to bring the top layer to be programming transistor of antifuse, so we can create a 3D FPGA using antifuse, but leaving all the antifuse technology for the upper wafer, where it could deal with a higher voltage required for the antifuse, and leaving the bottom wafer, the user logic, to be done at a standard fab. And that create a new type of FPGA. and we will talk more about it soon. In general, the better use of 3D integration is when the two wafers are not done at the same fab, and make better sense of integration this way, because if it's done at the same fab, maybe you can do it in just in one fab. You don't need two wafers. But if one of them is focused on one kind of technology, another wafer is another kind of technology, then the best way of integration will be 3D using hybrid bonding. And as I said, memory over logic could be one, and maybe a technology driver. In the past, it was image sensor over control logic by Sony. And I believe now the technology will be used in many ways, maybe RF over logic and so forth and so forth. We will focus, of course, for an FPGA on programming and user logic. So we are moving to the FPGA space. The first type of FPGA is anti-fuse based. So we're gonna have a base wafer that will be using conventional fab, and the upper wafer will use the programming transistor for the programming of the FPGA. And antifuse is becoming very common in the industry. Sometimes people call it RRAM, sometimes people call it other name like bridge RAM and so forth. So there are many technology, whether it's oxide breakthrough or other type of material. There are many variants of a antifuse or RRAM that change the resistivity and so forth. And the choice of the specific antifuse, I'm leaving for the specific team once they're going forward. As I said, there are many, many options now in the world, mostly being promoted as RRAM, sometimes as bridge RAM. Let's talk about the FPGA opportunity. Just like as now before, NRE is still escalating, so the opportunity is growing bigger. As a major player, Xilinx and Altera have both been acquired by CPU vendors, Intel and AMD, to service the artificial intelligence server market. So they still are providing FPGA, but they are not focused on FPGA space anymore. They are focused on AI and server, which leaves the room for a new entry to come in. The other aspect of the opportunity is that conventional scaling doesn't provide anymore the 2x cost advantage that it used to. So in the last 20 years, many people have attempted to come to the FPGA space to compete with Xilinx and Altera and always failed. And the number one reason is that the industry was scaling very quickly, and the market leaders, Xilinx and Altera, could quickly move to the next node and be a technology driver. And for years, if TSMC would announce a new node, they will bring Xilinx to talk with them about the new node, because Xilinx has been the technology driver. And by moving quickly to the next node, if you are a startup, you cannot afford every 2 years to redevelop the whole thing. And more than that, if you are an FPGA vendor, you need to provide master slice to any gate size, that meaning small amount of gate, medium amount of gate. So it's like 3x3 die, 5x5 die, 6x6, 7x7, 8x8, 9x9. How many master slice can you afford putting in when you have a very small market? And then you have to do all of that again. So people could not compete with FPGA, and the leaders, Xilinx and Altera, were driving it. Now they are not so aggressive, and more than that, you don't get so much benefit by scaling. So a startup would have a chance to stay at one node and not run so quickly before they build some market and being able to invest more to not go to the next node. And the other aspect is, if you build it from two wafer, then the FPGA technology associated with the antifuse could scale differently than the logic, and it's easier to scale. So it's easier to scale, and you don't need to scale so much. There is an opportunity. NRE is going up dramatically. So there is a lot of value for an FPGA offering because the end user need to be very careful in spending all that money unless they have the money like Apple. So there is huge opportunity in the semiconductor industry, but to access it, someone need to put all the NRE in place. And as you can see, it's hundreds of millions. So if someone offers a solution like an FPGA, it could be very attractive for many customers. So the general dilemma in the logic space is on the matrix between, let's say, processor all the way to dedicated hardware. And in between, you have FPGA and programmable DSP and so forth. And it's a trade-off between efficiency, both in performance and power, and cost versus programmability with a benefit on relatively time to market and lower NRE. And this trade-off is very painful because the customer want the best product to compete in the market, but also needs access to the product in the sense of reasonable NRE and reasonable time to market. And many times companies are very painfully have to choose how to go about it. But now, because of the huge NRE associated, there is more and more opportunity in this trade-off. And if one can offer an FPGA that has a good solution for the volume and still low NRE and short time to market, then it's very attractive. And that is what we can do with 3D. This is another way to show the same thing, the trade-off, and let's move forward. So before we go to the specific, let's learn something. And in FPGA, but I would dare to say that in all electronic system, it's all about interconnect anymore. So the number one reason FPGA are inefficient is interconnect. But interconnect is actually the Achilles heel of all electronic circuitry, because transistors have been improved dramatically as we move more with Moore law, while interconnect has gone the other way around. They become less and less conductive as they are getting thinner and smaller, and they have more and more capacity as they get closer between lines. So the trend in scaling is great for transistor and not so great for interconnect. Specifically for FPGA, if one use programmable transistor, programmable interconnect, then the most painful aspect of FPGA would actually be the interconnect. It's like 80% of the area, 75% of the delay, 60% of the power, and so forth and so forth. So huge penalty for having programmable interconnect. Let's talk more about it. So on the left side of the following chart, you can see how SRAM FPGA are doing the interconnect. The classic old way was a pass transistor, a pass gate. So it's still a memory and a transistor. And the transistor need to be pretty large. Then because that became not effective as scaling goes, people have moved to a transmission buffer, which now need a chunky, much more than one transistor, and still a memory, or even bidirectional buffer. That's the way interconnect are conduct within FPGA. But it's even worse, because those things are happening at the diffusion layer. So the interconnect is on top, and you have to go down to the diffusion to connect them, and you have even more severe penalty. Alternatively, it's the via connectivity, where it could be done between metal at the top, like metal 6 to metal 7, just via, and the size is very small. And a company that took it forward was ASIC, recently acquired by Intel and still being offered by Intel, so people can read about the concept of a structured ASIC with via programmability is in the market today, offered by Intel. But one of the penalty of the conventional via connectivity is you need a mask, which means turnaround is not instant, it's few weeks, and there is some NRE. So you have a significant advantage versus conventional FPGA, but you don't have the ultimate of field programmability, which for many people is really a painful decision. So what in this concept of FPGA we are offering is a new way to do FPGA. A via configurable, where the via itself is configurable. So first, just before we go into the detail of the FPGA, the work done by Intel or ASIC show that the power penalty will be now just between 1 to 2. The cost will be about 2x. The speed will be about 70%. So you're getting a pretty good ASIC, especially if you are doing it in advanced node when the user could compete against NRE of a node behind, then you are equally. This is the work done by Intel and EASIC. In a via configurable FPGA, we're getting even better. Not better as far as the penalty goes, but better as far as the ease of access versus production. So what do we do? We're getting all the benefit of FPGA with not so much penalties going for the volume production. How we do that? Here it is. We have in the left side the field programmable device, where you have an antifuse, and the upper layer is a programming circuitry. That in the left side, when you need prototype, you need time to market, you want to do it quickly and low cost. And that device will be a little bit more expensive because it has two layers. It has a user layer and the programming layer. But once you don't do any more prototyping, once you have a production, you now can commit to a via mask and get rid of all the programming circuitry. So now your production cost with a little NRE and a little bit time to market, now you are ready to do production at minimum cost. So you're getting now the ability to have a twin part, a prototyping part and the equivalent for high volume production at much lower cost. And sometimes better performance, depending on the choice of the antifuse. So it's like a match made in heaven. What you need for early time market is a fully programmable, but once you're ready for production, you just get rid of all the programming circuitry, commit to a via, and you are done. The programming itself, because this via is only the interconnect, the programming underneath is still lookup table, just like EASIC was doing. So you have a structure that had programmable logic style lookup table, normally like FPGA, and the top, the interconnect, is via configurable. The via configurable could be done differently between prototype and volume. I think this summarizes the first type of FPGA, and here is where we can see it, where you have all the antifuse and the programming transistor on the top. This is how you can create PED to access the programming transistor at the top. I will skip for the issue of time, the issue of smart alignment, and we can talk about it at another time. So as a summary, we have new type of FPGA that allow, that is a 3D, having logic structure and programming structure bonded together with hybrid bonding, when the programming structure would be removed for volume production. So it's a via configurable fabric with a field programmable twin. And that's the first type of FPGA that is now available and seems to be using all type of technology that has already been in the market for other purposes. I think we are ready to move to the next type of FPGA. This is FPGA using shared litho. So now we're talking a much higher level of innovation. And we don't have too much time, so we might end up leaving some question marks, and whoever show interest can go and read more deeply about it in the book chapter, or contact us and we can talk more about it. So now again, between efficiency and flexibility, the classic trade-off, but all of a sudden we can create an FPGA that will have lower cost, lower power, higher speed than dedicated full custom device. And one could say how that could be possible. It seems to be impossible. How can you get both FPGA and better density than full custom or standard cell? And the answer is a breakthrough 3D technology. So now we're talking about a much more aggressive concept. It leveraged the 3D NAND concept that was invented by Toshiba, presented first in 2007, and now dominates the 3D NAND market, or the NAND market. When Toshiba presented first, they called it BICS, Bit Incremental Cost Scaling. And it utilized a 3D structure processed in a 2D way, which is a complex concept. We will try to show some picture to make it more clear. It's fully programmable logic and routing, very high density. You can provide embedded memory. You can provide a good product all the way through. So let's talk about the concept. So let's start with what Toshiba presented when they presented first the BICS concept. They say, okay, let's stack plates. It was usually oxide and poly, oxide and poly. Once you create this sophisticated substrate of multi-level, you process all of it together and you drill holes. They called it punch. Then you plug in the channel, the memory cell. So if you notice, you have many levels. The first product at the time, I think it was 2013, offered by Samsung, started with 24 layers, then Samsung followed up with 36, and then 48, and 72, and these days, Hynix and Micron are announcing products at 100, and even Toshiba, I believe. Toshiba is now called Kioxia. Now, I think they're offering 170 layers. So that is the concept of big scaling. So you have many, many levels, and you drill holes in all of them together. Then you fill the hole in all of them together. So you're creating transistor on many levels, but the process itself is a 2D, because you process all of them together. So you share the litho, you share the process. And that is how you scale the price. So it's a cost. This is another picture showing the concept. now more detail about the concept, but I think we are not going to drill it down. The Samsung offers that even for vertical RAM. So this chart shows the benefit of PICs. When DRAM scaling is almost not happening anymore, big scaling continue aggressively and shows order of magnitude benefit. So how can we use this concept for FPGA? It's similar concept with some variation. What we're showing over here is a multi-level structure. In this case, it could be silicon and silicon. You etch all of that and create, instead of just punch, you have a ridge and holes and valleys. And the programming will be just like a memory. So a memory is a device, and let's talk about charge trap memory, the non-volatile memory. We're trapping charge in the charge trap level, and as we're trapping electrons there, we're shifting the curve or the threshold curve. So a normal transistor is shown in the middle of this chart, and always on is shown where, and then always off when it's fully charged with electron, then you shift the threshold to the right. So it's always off at a normal operating voltage. You can program it for always on by charging it positively, and it takes longer, but if you charge holes in the nitride, then it's always on. So charge trap could be used also not just as a memory, but also as a programming structure to change the resistivity of a path. And we use this for this programmable FPGA. So if you remember before, we had this ridge and valleys, now we're putting the gates around them. And the structure could look like here, where you put the gates, you put more, and you create staircase to get access. And then you can segment blocks with junctionless in between them. And now let's talk about programmable logic. So assuming we are able to create a vertical structure where we have, let's say, a conductive structure, a poly in a charge trap over here, and then another conductive structure, and another channel over here, and again, gates around it and charge trap over here. And this structure could allow us to build a LUT 2. So by programming those transistors to conduct or to be off, we create in this structure where this will be the output, this will be ground, and by programming the gate, this is the gate, those are vertical structures. This is A and A naught, B and B naught, so those will control. Those are the two inputs, A and B are the input, but you have also the complement. And those two inputs could control this structure. So with the programming of those P locations, we can build LUT 2, meaning we bring two signals here and we're getting output, and the output will be depend on how we program it. And here is the table. The table has X, where it's in, not connected, or T, where it's a transistor acting, and And the output over here is a full lookup table showing of it. If you have A node, B and B node, and this is how you program the first structure. So we have those four transistors to program and those four transistors to program. And based on the lookup table that we want, we can program them accordingly. So if the A and B are defined here, this will be the output, depend on how we program those transistors. We program, if we leave it as a transistor, meaning the charge up is not charged, then this will be the output. If we program this transistor to be always off, this transistor always off, this will be the output and so forth. And you can see a full lookup table could be built in this little structure here. This is a lookup table of two. Now, if we look in this structure, I'm gonna first go over here, sorry, I'll go back. This is how we implement LAT4, and this vertically in the structure. So it's four times LAT2, and you have them here. And the output of the first LAT2 and the output of the second LAT2 and so forth are going over here to a selector of C and C node, D and D node. And this will be the output of the LAT4. So this way, in the structure, we can build a LAT4 by programming those transistors according to this chart. And then we can add between transistor another vertical stuff that will be actually an ARM as a conductor for interconnect. And we can connect them over here. This is a connection region to get connected. So we if this is a structure between transistors that are functioning as a lookup table, we can create pillars that will be programmable interconnect vertically. And now we can take the output of LAT4. So we can implement LAT4 in the structure. So over here, if we have multiple of those, we can create LAT4 vertically. And in between them, we can have pillar to create connectivity. Those are the connectivity. On top of all of that, we can create a logic to convert the signal to a true 0 and 1. So if we build in the 3D NOR fabric LAT4, we can build two LAT4, one LAT and the complementary LAT. The ghost gonna get the A, B, C, D. So you see the complementary A node, B node, C node, and so forth. Those are the four inputs that become eight gates into this structure, and the two complementary LAT are programmably inverse. So one has a LAT out and one has a LAT not out. Those are inverse. And this structure convert this to a normal signal. So you have the LAT4 and on top you have a circuitry to support it. That's the control circuitry is done separately. So if you have the matrix of the bits of the memories, on top of it, you have the control electronics that you bring with hybrid bonding to control it. And the control electronic will be both taking signal, inverting them, powering them, and driving them down at the gates, and the output come out at the top to become a signal again, to become the next ABC. This could also be a latch, so that you have kind of a conventional lookup table of logic and sequential. Just as a concept, this latch could be replaced with more sophisticated circuitry as a differential amplifier to reconstruct the signal. And in this fabric, you can also implement horizontal wires. And this shows the horizontal wires to create programmability. So in general, you can program the whole structure to incorporate both the logic and the interconnection. And everything is differential. Both the logic is differential and also the interconnection is differential. And you have at the top circuitry to convert the differential signal to a true signal to drive it back. The differential could be differential amplifier or latch type circuitry. The fabric itself would be fabricated like normal memory, but will include both the memory structures and the interconnect structure. The memory structure will be charge trap. The interconnect will be RRAM or one-time programmable, like antifuse. Both will be fabricated together and programmed later on. And on top of all of that, you're gonna have this circuitry to control it. So what do we get? We'll get a 3D NOF FPGA density, assuming that the fabric itself has 32 layers, and we assume some pitch, you can support a very high density, providing 37 million gate per millimeter square at relatively not too aggressive technology. If you go at the top layer with something like 7 nanometers, you're getting a density that are even higher. And you can create a very high density device at relatively very low cost, because all the structure is processed together in a way. So in a way, you have another kind of programmable logic. This time, it's fully programmable, very short turnaround time, shared litho, built-in thermal conductivity, very low power, very high speed, and very high density. So basically, there are two paths for FPGA. One that is relatively more straightforward, more conventional thinking, and represent maybe by this chart. This is maybe step one. And if you want to go really aggressive, there is a path to leverage the 3D NAND technology. And just as a concept, the shared litho concept, it builds that you process all the layers together. Programmable logic is like memory. It's a memory that when later you program it. So in the time of processing, everything is together. So it could share the same manufacturing that is done now for 3D NAND to build logic. So two concepts, all of them are 3D. One of them is relatively simple. The other one, I think will take a little bit more time, but it basically, it's following this concept here that it's called BICS. And maybe what we presented over here. And hopefully you got at least as a teaser, there are more information in the book, you have more time to read it. And I think with that, I'm opening for question and answer.
Thank you very much, impressive. Impressive. You sent most of us to the school again.
Sorry.
Mr. Professor Boda, you have worked hardly to develop new processes at our Romanian company years ago, but you see so huge step ahead since then. Mr. Professor Bodea, can you turn on your microphone? No, I think he cannot turn on the microphone.
Stefan, do you have any question of your own? So everybody else could think about their question.
Now, imagine that we have a very precise circuit to be implemented. First question is, what CAD tools you use to design this?
The CAD tools will be basically an adaptive tools that are used today for the FPGA, because it's all still a lot for oriented FPGA. So from a CAD point of view, the infrastructure currently exists in the world, Xilinx and Altera and other people, is relevant. You don't need new type of tools. You may need to adapt those tools, I mean, for place and route, all of those things. But the fundamental synthesis and all of that is the same tools, basically, that have been supporting FPGA for the last 20 years. Okay. It's a lot more best FPGA.
And now let's imagine that we have something in mind of the scale of, say, 1 million gates. Let's say, just an example, because you mentioned huge numbers. How long it takes from the first drawing to the final product to market? How long will take this?
I think that in general, whatever time it would take you with existing FPGA could be the same. So this technology allow you to get to a different physical product, but the flow is very similar to what you could see with Xilinx or Altera. So a million gate is usually going to take you a few weeks from, let's say, an RTL to a fully ready to market product. But while the implementation will be very, very different between SRAM-based FPGA to this type of FPGA, since it's a lookup table and conventional FPGA, from those point of view, it should be very similar flow.
Such that you said that from the time to market point of view, the two technology are very much the same.
Yes.
Okay. And in terms of the speed, working speed,
the working speed of those technology will be much better than the SRAM-based FPGA, not because of the lookup table, but because of the programmable interconnect. So in normal FPGA, the interconnect goes through those transmission gate or bidirectional buffers, and that slowed down the interconnect quite a bit. In this technology, between output and input, it's all basically metal. You're going to have much better speed. So that is in the antifuse base. In the other concept, because it's differential, it's again much better speed. So this technology provides much better speed than conventional FPGA.
It appears that this is very new technology.
Right.
Which of the vendors, say TSMC and others, which of those huge company are prepared to use this?
Well, I think that if you want to use someone like TSMC for the first concept, maybe the attribute base, then you can use TSMC for the logic fabric, but the antifuse fabric, you might use someone like STMicro or someone else that is not so aggressive, and then bond those two wafers together. I'm not sure, but of course, TSMC also have other fabs, and they may offer you support for antifuse circuitry, because you need, I mean, the logic could be less than 1 volt, but the antifuse is usually 3 volt, so it's a different circuitry, and sometimes you're going to find it more available at more, it's an older node and not the most aggressive node. But the beauty with this 3D concept is those two wafers could be done, one could be done at the TSMC, which will do the high volume production, and one could be done at a older node and just support the prototyping. So you can do mix and match. As far as the other concepts, the BIX type concept, then you need probably to approach one of the memory guys, because I don't think you're going to find the experience to do kind of a drill and punch and feel that associated with the BIX in the conventional logic fab. So if you want to go with the second concept, then you probably want to try to talk with one of the 3D NAND companies and try to access some of the older fabs when they may have used for the early generation of 3D NAND and now they are moving ahead. But the second concept is more challenging. The early concept is much straightforward, and with the antifuse kind of thing, sorry about it. Anyway, so from a fabrication process, I think there is an opportunity to do European project where the FPGA will be built in Europe in some of the older fab like TSMC, but maybe some of the logic fabric could be done at much more advanced fabs, or to do it with global foundries that have fab both in US and Europe.
Thank you very much. Please, more question. I don't want to monopolize this, please.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
I don't know if you see me and you hear me. Okay, yeah, thank you for
your question. Yes, I can hear you.
Now, I'm an analog IC designer, so it's interesting what your presentation was interesting, but I don't have technical questions on it. Instead, I wonder if you can help me with one issue. One problem or one question I don't find yet a proper answer to, and it may look silly, right? But it's also for the benefit of a PhD student who attends this call and with whom I co-author a patent application. So the question is, how can one make money out of a circuit patent?
Very simple.
I didn't manage.
First, you have to file a patent.
Sorry?
First, you have to file the patent.
Well, we did that, right?
And you have to file it in a proper jurisdiction, meaning you're only going to get money from someone who needs a patent. And if that someone is building the product and selling it, not in the jurisdiction the patent is being filed. So for example, if you file in Romania, you might not be in a good position to extract money out of it, because I don't know how much the Romanian market is important. You find it in Europe, it's a better situation. You find it in US, it's even better. So first, you have to file it in the right jurisdiction. Then you have to make sure that you have a good patent. And if you really believe in your idea, do file a continuation. And that's a very important point. I'll get to it in a short while. Then you need to be lucky, because someone needs to build it. Now, if they're already building it, they may want to pay for your patent. If they are not building it, maybe they'll say, you have a patent and there is exclusivity. Give us exclusivity. We will build it and we have some benefit for it. And because we can have some exclusivity, it worth money for us. So you need either to be lucky that someone is already building it, or with the right business connection to sell the concept. Now, if you sell a concept with a patent, you have a chance, because if you sell the concept without a patent, then it's very hard to convince people to pay you and not just steal it. If you have a patent and they decided they like it, they may pay for it. And last but very important, once you, the patent application is not really a money generating, although someone can say, I'll pay for it too. But most likely it's all about the claim. The claim need to be clear, and that's not an easy task for a novice. Someone need to understand how to do it. You have to claim so nobody can do it, this invention, without infringing the claim, but nobody should be able to find a prior art that infringes the claim. So how to really do a good patent, it's very challenging for someone that have not spent time in the patent space. So all of those are challenges. In general, it's not an easy game, let me say it like that. It's much easier to spend your money on patent than to pull money out of it.
Okay, yeah, well, now that's, thank you very much. So this is useful. Because you see, I've been through this phase of being very excited about patents and working for them, and then expect some sort of recognition. But with age, I grew a bit wiser. The trouble is, for younger designers, it's not a good experience at all, and I don't want to do it. To explain them that yes, it's great you are creative and try something new, but at the end of the day, it won't bring you much, because in circuit design is so complicated. You need somebody, as you said, to build it, and then somebody to think, okay, it's not only useful, but it can be differentiated without breaking the chip from what the competition does. And at the end of the day, it's only 5 transistors out of a few millions, and we'll never know if somebody copies it. So the trick is how, or the answer I haven't found yet, how to keep a young designer interested in patents as a recognition of their creativity and so on, without expecting too much recognition out of that.
Well, one thing is, a provisional patent is usually not so expensive. It's really not expensive. And you have a chance, at least for a while, to have a patent in potential to see if there is a commercial opportunity behind it. And for most people, this should be enough. Meaning, if within a year between filing the provisional patent, you couldn't find anyone who showed interest, unless you have deep pocket and high confidence and connection, leave it. Go on and keep on doing it. At one day, it will be good enough for you to stick on it. So I would say it like that. Patents are a fantastic way if you're creating a product and you are a startup, then VC like to know that you have a patent. Patents are a fantastic way if you have innovation and you want to convince someone to give you some money, and they need to feel that it's not going to be easy to just copy you. But just as an end product, it's much more challenging. It requires much more experience. And I would say, don't start diving into it early in your life. Do a provisional. It's $100, $200. It gives you the exercise, give you a year to live the dream. And within a year time, you don't find enough momentum behind it. Keep on going. You're young enough. At some point of time, you might hit gold. This might be just a fuller gold or whatever. Okay. But that's a good way to start without drowning.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you very much, and hope the youngsters who attend this will appreciate your advice as well. Thank you.
And just for the record, I do have now more than 280 patents. So clearly, I believe in patents.
By the way, I once tried to read one of your patents, and I found there were 300 pages, a single patent.
Yes, we had one with 600 pages, so you took one that is not the largest.
Now, multiply 300 pages of 300 patents, how much paper? It's a lot.
Well, not every patent is 600 pages, but more than that, for one 600 pages application, we have generated more than 20 patents. So there is patent, but then you do continuation, you change the claim and you file it again. The beauty with the 600 page patent, you can generate many, many patents out of it. So it's a one application, but then you continue and continue. So let me say just one word about the continue. Usually at the time of filing, even if you file something very, very good, you might not be able to come up with the best claim, especially since you don't know yet where is the competition, what was done before, what was done. So if you file continuation, you have more time. And what you do with the continuation, you just change the claim. You don't change just the patent, the spec itself stays, just new claims. And you can do it for the life of the patent. We have now a patent that was filed 10 years ago, and we are now filing more continuation because now we know what the market is doing. So this presentation was about hybrid bonding. At the time we filed the 600 pages, we did cover hybrid bonding, but we also covered other techniques. What we know now is that the 3D integration will go with the hybrid bonding. So now we are finding more claims built on hybrid bonding, which we didn't know at the early days. So very important, once you go for a patent, is if you think you have a good invention, as soon as you know that you're going to get a patent, file a continuation. By the way, in Europe, I believe it's called divisional. So there are different names in different jurisdictions, but most jurisdictions allow you to generate from one patent multiple derivatives.
I think somebody tries to tell us something, but we cannot hear. Mr. Malinka, is it you?
Sorry, I was inviting people to ask questions and take opportunity for this good moment. Yes, I was.
They seem to have some people have some trouble with their microphones. So it looks very interesting. Do you see any extension into analog? The fablid analog FPGA type thing. I think Cyprus was doing it 20 plus years ago. It never got anywhere. Even in Romania, back more than 30 years ago, Professor Godea may remember, there was an interesting product. So this was in early 80s, in fact. It was called microchip, if you can remember, if you can imagine. And it was a sea of high-speed differential amplifiers, bipolar, and you could connect them on with metal. So the idea was, you know, the they just had a lot of these high-speed NPN diff pairs and biasing sources and a few current mirrors, and which were stopped before metal, and then the user could simply connect them. So that was the concept was early 80s, and I was thinking that even if they had retained the name microchip, they could have made a lot of money out of it. Do you remember that, Professor Bode? That was, I think, ICCE. And I think also Mr. Stănescu worked on that. This is how I met him a long time ago.
Mă auziți?
Vă auzim, spuneți, domnul Stănescu.
Professor Bode wants to say something. I will let him be first.
Mă auziți?
Da.
Ok, I
așteptăm de mult, așteptăm de mult.
I would like to ask you about the redundancy you have to provide, let's say, in a sea of 1 billion connection, as an example. Do you think about to provide some redundancy?
The beauty with an FPGA is because the fabric itself is very generic. How you build the circuitry out of it, it's up to you. You can build the redundancy if the application required. It's more like the specific circuitry you put in it, meaning the fabric is just repetition of resources, and how you throw application on it, it's up to you. And you can throw one application, or you can throw two applications, which one is a redundancy for the other. Now, having said that, we have developed concept of redundancy with the 3D, but this could be at a different presentation. But FPGA itself inherently is a very generic structure. It's just an array of units, if you like, of that each unit could be any function you want. So you can make two units to be identical, one redundancy of the other, but it's going to be the circuit design you throw in it. It doesn't have to be the FPGA resources itself. Resource itself is like something you build into whatever you want to.
Thank you. It's a very interesting paper, very interesting approach. And the achievement is impressive. Thank you. Thank you.
So, Mr. Or-Bach, thank you for your presentation. I'm trying to respond to a certain extent to Professor Neag. The actual name of that circuit was not microchip, but monochip, if I recall.
Yes.
It was through in ICCE, our Romanian Institute for Electronic Components, which was also my first place where I have worked for 13 years. And I want to say that from the analog point of view, this kind of configurable array had some interest, limited interest, only for, let's say, quick project, which could be solved in a couple of months. and with a medium complexity, but FPGA, I think it's designated more likely to digital than to analog. Unfortunately or fortunately, I don't know how to say, but I think this is my opinion.
I think over the years, analog programmable logic has been proposed by multiple people, never became commercially successful. And if you think about it, there are many, many products in the world today that you have many, many, many millions of transistors doing logic. And I don't know of one analog function that in production of million transistors doing analog. So that's tell you the difference between analog and digital. And the million transistors doing logic, they count them in how many NAND gates they got there, kind of thing. Meaning one, the NAND function can do all the logic you want. In analog, you have so many different functions. So you have few transistors and you need them, some of them to be operational, some of them to do that, some of them to do common mirror. So analog circuitry is not similar to digital, and FPGA has been a good fit for digital. Analog usually is an older generation. I don't need to go to 3 nanometer, and I don't think there is even one analog function today that's going to be attempting to do it 3 nanometer. But ask Apple, and they are all about 3 nanometer.
I can see a place of interest in analog design. In most of the analog signal chain converters, we use one-time program memory, OTP, such that sometimes this part of the chip it's quite large, because we use different type of how to use fuses, thin film fuses, poly fuses, which take a lot of area. And specifically for those application, I see a place to use this.
Well, I would like to ask you about, you know, another difference I can see about between what I think possible in analog and what you presented. And that's heating, right? So that self-heating becomes more of a problem for high performance analog, especially in power management, but also in high speed. And such an elaborate structure may not be able to deal with that. What do you think? I don't think that's a problem, I suppose, in FPGA.
I don't have a very good opinion about it. At some point of time, it's not about concepts, it's about implementation, and it shifts to a different type of design. There's a lot of EDA tool to deal with the heating, because heat become more and more problem, and it's not anymore about the concept, it's how you build the circuitry, where you add controls, where you take power off, all of those things. So I don't know what to tell you about it. It's not an area that I became expert on.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? If not, Mr. Or-Bach, maybe you can have some question for us.
I'll give you a general remark. If any of you have an interest to learn more about it, to consider starting or be involved with a startup, please let Stefan know, because we didn't propose a solution, we propose an opportunity. But to make this opportunity a reality, someone need to work it out, and that is now available. And if anyone want to go for it, let us know.
Now, many thanks. It was really impressive for most of us, your so deep knowledge on this, which is covered by so many patents, so many publications, so many products, so many. You are yourself an industry.
Thank you very much for this compliment, and hopefully we all get to see a better world out there tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you. For
bye.
Everybody.
Thank you. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.